Mr. Speaker, I want to also participate in this moment that I consider a very important moment in contributing to this bill that is before us. And let me begin by saying that indeed I feel privileged that this is the second time that I happen to be a member of parliament when we are actually amending the constitution. And I want to say I was actively involved prior to the 2010 constitution in the clamor for a new constitution. And many lives were lost. Many, many lives were lost. And Mr. Speaker, I'll never forget the number of times we went to the streets of this city and in many other towns in this country trying to push for a new constitution. And one of the biggest things that really drove us to do that was to make sure we had a constitution that treated all Kenyans equally. A constitution that gives freedoms and rights to the people of Kenya. A constitution that ensured that this Kenya belonged to everybody. And therefore, Mr. Speaker, I consider any effort to review the 2010 constitution as a very important process, a sacred process, a process that cannot, should not be seen to be taking away any gain that we fought for in the 2010 constitution. If it does so, even in the smallest way, it becomes a real threat to the future of this nation. Mr. Speaker, the independence constitution was amended well over 29 times. And in each single amendment, Mr. Speaker, it took away from the people and gave more power to the executive. It became such a distorted document until the final document could not even be compared to the first document. And I would hate personally, as a member of this House, to be one of those that played a role in changing a constitution and taking away whatever gains the citizens of Kenya had gotten out of the 2010 constitution. And therefore, I'm listening to some very good things being said about this bill. And there are some very good things in this bill. But I want to tell this House that there are some very, very dangerous amendments in this bill that we are moving to amend the 2010 constitution that will become a real issue, many, many years down the line. And we had hoped that we had created a constitution that will pass the test of time. We had hoped that we'll not have people wanting to do what those others had done to the independence constitution by wanting to give themselves power at the expense of Mwananchi or at the expense of Kenyans. And therefore, Mr. Speaker, one of the things I'm asking myself is just how important are these amendments? First of all, at a time when Kenyans are expecting that we should be more sensitive to the real issues affecting them, one of them being the corona pandemic and the impact it has had on the citizenry. Today, many Kenyans have lost their jobs. Today, many Kenyans do not even know where to earn a living. Today, many Kenyans cannot access the vaccine. But all of us in this House have been vaccinated, Mr. Speaker. So for me, I worry about that. But let me move on, Mr. Speaker, to speak about the real issue today. Mr. Speaker, can the Leader of Majority just let me contribute without interrupting me?
It's a point of order. Leader of Majority.
Honorable Speaker, I did not intend to interrupt any member.
Let me have my chance.
Because this is a constitutional moment. But the Honorable Nominated Member, Sisi Bari, has just made a very serious allegation that there are some dangerous provisions that are contained within this bill. Does not go ahead to tell us which are these dangerous provisions in this bill and proceed no, and proceeds to tell us about corona, which is not included in this bill. Is she in order to mislead this house that, no, is she in order to mislead this house that and Kenyans that there are some dangerous provisions within this BBI bill without mentioning those provisions, and then goes ahead to totally irrelevant matters dealing with pandemics and other that are not the subject matter of this bill?
You know, Mr. Speaker, with all respect to the Leader of Majority, if you had accepted to sit right where you are and give me time, I was going to those dangerous clauses. So please just don't disrupt me. Allow me to speak. And I want to say this, Mr. Speaker. When we were amending the 2010 Constitution, because the Constitution is about all of us, all Kenyans, the then government allowed people to give their views. The then government allowed even ministers. I remember the Minister for Agriculture then, Honorable William Ruto, the Minister for Special Programs then, Naomi Shaban, were in the no camp. But nobody intimidated them. So don't think you'll come here and intimidate me.
Please, honourable members, so that...
Mr. Speaker,
just allow me to
proceed, Mr. Speaker. Sorry, Mr. Speaker. Allow me to proceed. Mr. Speaker, one of the things that we fought for when we were fighting for the 2010 Constitution was the independence of the institutions of government, was the independence of the three arms of government. And if there was a big gain that we gained as the people of Kenya, was to ensure that the three arms of government, executive, parliament, judiciary, were truly, truly independent. Some of you who probably never had a chance to face the wrath of the dictator regime that was there then may not appreciate those gains. But those that followed what was going on then will appreciate that one of the major gains we achieved was really the independence of the three arms of government. The minute we allow the executive to have control of parliament, the minute we allow the executive to have control of the judiciary, that is the beginning of the end of our democracy, Mr. Speaker. And so allow me to mention some of those things that I find not good for this nation going forward. One of them, Mr. Speaker, and by the way, that is why one Honorable Raila Odinga, who I respect very much, fought very hard for that new constitution. And if there's a man I know went out of his way, sacrificed for the 2010 Constitution, it was the Honorable Raila Odinga. It is sad that again we are taking away those gains and he happens to be supporting. But allow me, Mr. Speaker, to begin with the issue, Mr. Speaker, of the judiciary. Mr. Speaker, the judiciary is very, very important. Mr. Speaker, I want to tell you that if judiciary is not fully dependent, any of us seated here can be a victim. If the judiciary was not independent, TJ Kajwang would be behind bars right now of treason. TJ Kajwang would be behind bars today of treason, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, what is happening? One of the things that this bill has done is to take away, is it page 14? I'm trying to get to the judiciary. Sorry, Mr. Speaker. Yes, it says this, Article 47, that the Judicial Service Commission, on top of all the functions that are already stipulated in the current constitution, it goes further to say that the Judicial Service Commission will receive complaints against judges, investigate, discipline judges by warning, reprimanding, or suspending of a judge. Currently, Mr. Speaker, in the current constitution, the thing that the judicial service does is they will investigate, they will come up with their findings, they'll take it to the president, who will then form a tribunal. Now, what is happening by bringing this particular amendment, it means that judges going forward are fully exposed. Their security of tenure is under threat, Mr. Speaker. The security of tenure of the judges going forward is under threat, Mr. Speaker. Where will we get justice if a judge knows that they have a chance
members,
that they could lose their job?
Get a point of argument. I mean,
yes, please, that's my opinion. You'll have your chance. Mr. Junet, you even already...
You know, somebody else will come and say...
Please.
Somebody else will have an opportunity. Sorry, I'll give you back your... I'll give you back your two minutes.
Yes.
But somebody else is at liberty to say, when they are exposed to the president, they are not as independent as when they are being dealt with. So this is one point. This is one side of the argument. So you can argue the opposite side. So
Mr. Speaker...
Yes, you have your time.
That for me worries me, because judges going forward will no longer have the independence that they enjoy right now. Then we go further and say we're establishing an office of the judicial ombudsman, who again is appointed by the president. Good people, where is the independence of the judiciary? Please tell me, where is the independence of the judiciary? Mr. Speaker, I want to move forward, Mr. Speaker, and talk about the National Police Service Commission. Mr. Speaker, the National Police Service Commission had very clear functions in the 2010 Constitution. But I think somewhere along the way, somebody got uncomfortable with the fact that the Police Service Commission was doing its job and a few people are uncomfortable that they are not able to control the running of that commission. So as a result, what have we done? Taken away key functions of the National Police Service Commission and given them to an individual called the IG. This is a person who can receive a phone call anytime and is given instructions and he can do anything. So what have we said? We have said, Mr. Speaker, I'm losing my eyesight, Mr. Speaker, I'm growing older. We have said this, Mr. Speaker, that we, in clause 2, we delete paragraph B and substitute, therefore, the following new paragraph. That the B shall exercise independent command over the service, that is the IG, determine promotions and transfers within the service, that is the IG, exercise disciplinary control through suspension of officers in the service, that is the IG, perform any other functions prescribed by legislation. Good people, we are moving away from an institution called a commission and taking these powers to an individual called the IG. Are we taking away gains? Or are we helping the National Police Service Commission? What happens to those officers who in the Moi days would go for years, you are a corporal for 40 years, you'll never be promoted because you don't belong to the right community. What happens to that officer? We are better off with a commission than an individual, good people. We must never create a law with an individual in mind. Yes. We create a law for posterity. Yes. That is what we were fighting for in 2010. Let me move forward, Mr. Speaker. We have a very important commission called the SRC. SRC is a commission that is constituted and stakeholders who will be affected by the decisions of that commission are represented in that commission. Mr. Speaker, SRC has a representative of the Parliamentary Service Commission, the Police Service Commission, the Judicial Service Commission, the Teacher Service Commission, the Defense Council, COTU, etc. Now, what this bill has done, they have decided that the SRC will be formed by commissioners who will come from wherever, professionals with the skill appointed by the executive. Now, who will protect the workers? Who will protect? Of course, you don't know workers because you don't care. That is what has happened to this house. I'm sorry. We've become very selfish, very self-driven. It's all about us. We don't care about wananchi. Otherwise, today, we'll be talking about the vaccine for these people. So, Mr. Speaker, I want to say this. While I know this is going to go on, this bill is going to go on anyway, because by the writers of the Constitution, our role seems to be very minimal. But let me say this. I pray that this thing doesn't go through. And why I say so is because this thing takes away gains that we fought for with our lives, with our sweat, with our blood. I pray this thing doesn't go through because I know one day we will have another president who will be worse than the previous dictators we've had in the past. And you people will come here to make noise about what will be going wrong at that time. And you are the ones responsible. So I want to go down.
Member for Seme. Member for Seme.